Welcome to SarderTV. I'm Vaishali Jain. We'd like to welcome Mark Babbitt to the studio today. Mark is founder and CEO of YouTern, a site that connects young talent and emerging business leaders and entrepreneurs. And he's also co-authored a book called A World Gone Social, How Companies Must Adapt to Survive, which he's here to talk about today. Mark, thank you so much for joining us today.
Of course.
It's so good to have you here.
Pleasure to be here.
So tell us why you decided to write this book, A World Gone Social.
Quite some time ago, we realized that we had left the industrial age, and companies weren't prepared for that. We weren't ready for the impact social media was going to have, not just on our personal lives, but our business lives too, and in just about every aspect, selling, recruiting, communications, employee engagement, everything changed almost overnight. And so the social age was born, and leaders weren't quite ready to deal with that yet.
Who would benefit most from reading this book?
Well, you know, when you write a book, you sit down and you think about that very question. And we realized we actually had two categories. We had those business people and leaders who were aware this change was coming and just had no idea how to deal with it. But then we also had the dinosaurs, we call them old white guys, an old white guy disease that were in total denial. They thought Facebook was for kids and social media was a fad. And the reality is they weren't going to read the book right away. They weren't going to read the book until the reality hit them so hard they had no choice but to change. And so we wrote for them too.
Industrial age is now over. And now we have entered the social age. Define for us what you mean by the social age.
So social age was first of all, we have to say it was a total accident. Mark Zuckerberg did not see this coming, even with all of his wisdom. We had no idea the impact that social media was going to have on business in general. So about 2007, when Facebook started to become really popular, we started to see people not just communicating with their friends, but communicating with business, both local and huge corporations on social media. And as soon as that started happening, it became this undeniable force. And the fact is we've been leaving the industrial age slowly. We've had the digital age, the informational age, the computer age. Well, ages don't last 5 to 7 years. They are literally an age, right? Industrial age, 100 years plus. And all of those didn't quite have the impact that social media and the social age has. So we define the social age as about 2007 on, when people started going to their devices, handheld laptops, iPads, everything, just as frequently as they made eye contact with other humans. And it became a human form of communication. And again, not just personal, but business too.
So what about some of the practices that have helped organizations traditionally become lean and profitable, like total quality management, like Six Sigma? How do those fit in to the social age?
Well, that's a great question. I grew up as an engineer in Silicon Valley, and I lived through those movements, those changes in how business was done, and they're still ultra relevant today. Here's the deal though, those movements, those industry standards, they kind of were a top-down thing, and CEOs had to push their companies hard to adopt those. Social media is not like that. The social age is not like that. We see middle out and bottom up change happening all the time. And sometimes, in spite of a leader's best intentions, we see companies going social and the CEO doesn't even know it.
So then is it about revamping the way some of these models have been used in the past?
Well, it's applying active listening and social monitoring and true engagement, not talking at people, your customers, your potential customers, your employees, but talking with them. I mean, when you think about like TQM, total quality management, that's really what TQM was all about. Get the right people in the right room at the right time and solve a problem. Well, the trouble was corporate America took that in and we put 13 suits VP and above in the right room at the right time, but it wasn't the right people. And the social age is telling us we really have to have the difference makers, the impact makers in the room. It can't be a delegate. It can't be a VP. It can't be somebody in a suit that happens to have the right title. It has to be a problem solver.
What are you seeing happening to leaders and organizations who aren't prepared for the social age?
Oh, they're struggling. They're really struggling. And it's not, I don't think it's epidemic status yet, but we've already seen where where a board of directors will realize they have to maybe make a change at the top. And one of the first criteria they're looking for is social intelligence. They're looking for somebody who understands how the social age works. And we say this all the time, kind of tongue in cheek, but not really, that soon there's going to be two kinds of leaders. There's going to be a social leader and a retired leader. And there really is no in between. And so what's happening to those old white guys is they are, through attrition, through their own volition, they're realizing this is not how I was taught to lead, and I'm maybe not the right guy right now.
Have you seen that there's a lot of resistance to change amongst some of these leaders who haven't been able to completely embrace it?
It all gets back to sticking with what we think we know and what we've been taught versus what the world needs now from our leaders. And it's nobody's fault, but when we went to business school, when we worked with our mentors, when we went to graduate school, when we went through all of these processes in the 60s and 70s, these older white gentlemen, they weren't taught how to be vulnerable. They weren't taught how to be social. They weren't taught ever to communicate with their employees or their customers. We talked at people. We directed people. We were loud. We were decision-oriented. We had all the answers. And it's just not how leadership works today. So the change is there, and it's mostly a function of, if I change now, I'm giving up everything I know, and that gets me out of my comfort zone. That's out of my control, and that's, for many leaders, that is not a comfortable place to be.
Can you provide us a case study about a company who perhaps has failed, or a leader who's failed, or who hasn't been able to adapt to the social change?
Well, absolutely, and it's not just companies. In some cases, it's entire industries. You look at Bank of America and the entire financial arena. It's a stable, a barn full of old white guys, and to a certain point, fairly arrogant old white guys, you know, too big to fail kind of mentality. And you see the debacles that have happened with Bank of America and Wells Fargo and UBS. You see these great examples of people who maybe they tried to go into social media, but oh, they did it completely wrong. And they started sending out all these automated messages, and they completely underestimated the power of the consumer and the backlash from that approach, and it especially for the financial industry and the airline industry to a certain extent. And we pick on United Airlines quite a bit in the book for that very reason. It's hard for these legacy companies to adapt quickly and to do it right.
What about an organization that was kind of maybe stuck in the industrial age but was able to embrace the social age and actually came about?
Well, there's where we find hope. There are examples all over the world of companies that are now doing amazing work. Even, you know, when you think of a staunch bureaucratic company, one of the first companies that comes to mind from my experience is IBM. And Ginni Romney walked in and said, no, we will be a social company. We will change. And so they set out to make 440,000 employees think about business differently. And they've done a wonderful job. But other well-known brands have done a great job. Oreo, Taco Bell, Denny's, they're all doing amazing work because they're actually talking with their customers. They're using sense of humor. They're using, it's a buzzword, but they're using an authentic approach to their engagement, and it's working really well for them. Again, you have to stop talking at people. Stop controlling the message. Ask your customers, what are we doing well? What are we not doing well? How can we make your life better? And when you start asking those very tough questions, and actually listening to the answers, and you apply that to that engagement mindset, all of a sudden you start doing really good work.
So now you've been talking about how there have been some really big seismic changes that are going on in the social age. One thing that you mentioned was messaging. And today there is little control that organizations themselves have over messaging. What other things are you seeing in terms of change and some of the things that are really impacting organizations?
The social age has changed everything, how we recruit, how we retain, how we communicate. In many cases, it's a matter of being in the right place at the right time. You know, our recruiting, for example, the hiring system was broken. And along comes social media, and we start actually communicating with people, not posting an ad on monster.com and getting 400 responses, four of which might be qualified, but actually communicating with people within our networks that know that they're a good culture fit. They know they're a good technical fit. They have both the soft and the hard skills to do the job well. I already know you. Wow, how refreshing, right? And so hiring and retention rates go way up in that environment versus stuck in that old paradigm that we kind of self-inflicted, right? When job boards came along, we did the exact opposite. We took the human out of human resources. we stopped developing relationships because all we had to do was click that apply now button 200 times and something good would happen. And along comes the social agent, completely turns that on its ear.
Can you give us an example of how an organization is doing this? How are they embracing recruiting to make things easier for themselves, and how is it different?
Well, Sodexo is a great example of this. They went all in on social media. They were one of the early adopters, and as they began engaging with potential employees, they did it on all fronts: LinkedIn groups, Twitter chats, Facebook communities, blogging. They asked their employees to write blogs. What's it like to work here? Right? And they started building this sense of community around the Sodexo employee brand, and it paid off in droves. I mean, not only did their hiring time go way down, but their retention rates went way up just again because they actually began communicating human to human with a potential candidate.
Compared to other hiring methods, would you say the social method works better?
Well, I think it does because, let's face it, in a resume, in your LinkedIn profiles, we say what we want people to hear, right? We read the job description, and then we literally alter our resume to accommodate the job description and the company culture, right? So it's not exactly a forthright way of meeting people. So social media, a recruiter can now go on social media and look at your Facebook page, look at your Twitter profile, look at Instagram, and they can really see, they can get an idea of what kind of person you really are. Not that person you portrayed on your resume, but who am I really bringing into my firm, and are they a good fit? And right or wrong, because some people think of it as stalking or an invasion of privacy, by doing that 5-minute cursory glance on those top candidates, we do learn a little something about them even before we bring them in for an interview.
What are some of the drawbacks of social recruiting?
Well, there's where people feel like their privacy is being invaded, a little stalker-ish. The other part of that too is we still seem to think that social media, as consumers, that's my private space, that's my personal space. And a lot of job seekers, a lot of careerists haven't yet learned that everything you put on social media is not private. It's out there, it can be seen literally by anybody, and God forbid you put something out there that's not positive, because it just might ruin your chances of getting a job.
Talk about how job seekers themselves are starting to change the way they look for jobs in the social age.
Well, that's one of the most exciting things about the social age is we have started learning how important that authentic personal brand is, that we need to engage our filters a little bit better, that we need to present, if we say we're a passionate developer on our resume, we have to prove that. We have to have social proof of that. We can't just say it because we have these informal background checks. We know people are going to social media. And the job seekers that are doing really well are leveraging that. They're putting social proof, testimonials, endorsements, blog posts, relevant coursework. They're putting all of that into their social brand. So when an employer goes there, they go, oh yeah, she can do the job, no problem. And those who aren't doing all of that, that are still stuck in the industrial age job search mode, they're hurting right now.
Talk about some of the measures of social recruiting. What is the ROI for social recruiting?
Well, that's still a wide gap between what leaders believe ROI of social recruiting is and reality. It's still so new that we haven't actually put a dollar figure on it. But we know that compared to a very broken system, that the job posting online application process, we know it's quicker. We know our retention rates are better, and we know that the cost per hire is actually substantially down from even 5 years ago. But here's the reality, and this is why ROI is so hard to determine, is the system was so broken before that nobody knew how bad it was. Nobody knew how archaic the process was. So we're comparing a 5-star restaurant to a Taco Bell. And so it's really hard to gain perspective. And when there's that much of a chasm, it's really hard to figure out the exact ROI.
You talk about something called the social media hammer. Tell us what that is and why that's important to organizations.
So social media hammer is an analogy we use a lot in our consulting work when we're helping legacy companies embrace the social age. And a hammer is an interesting analogy in this case because it's so analog, right? There's absolutely nothing high tech about a hammer. But here's the reality. A hammer, for those in the trades, can be both a construction tool and a deconstruction tool. And that's what a social media hammer can be. used correctly, social media can greatly improve your employer brand, your consumer brand, your engagement with your customers and your future employees, your current employees. But use it wrong and it can smash everything you've done, right? The social media lynch mob is just waiting for the opportunity. It only takes one mistake. You know, a CEO kicks a puppy in an elevator or says something silly online and everybody attacks. Look at Mr. Trump right now, right? One tweet and it gets a million retweets, a million comments. And so I'm not sure that every company and every leader understands how social media can be both the good side of a hammer and the deconstructive side of a hammer.
How can organizations better prepare themselves for worst-case scenarios now that so many employees and customers can so openly voice their opinions on social networks?
Well, this is where emotional and social intelligence comes into play, right? We cannot have a troll manning our Twitter handle. We just can't. We can't have an intern with no emotional intelligence handling that. And so many companies have learned the hard way what happens when you take an intern or a junior employee or somebody without much emotional or social intelligence and turn them loose on the Twitter account. HMV is a great example of this. In the middle of their layoffs, their social media team was broadcasting, oh, we all just got fired. And this is going out on the corporate stream, right? So we have to build that team based on, one, their passion for the brand. Like, just like you would never say a bad thing about your grandma, you would never say a bad thing about this company, right? And you don't have to be told that. You just know that person would never do that, right? So first of all, whoever's manning the controls of the social media accounts, you gotta make sure they're that brand ambassador that would never say anything bad about you. And second thing is, don't trust your social media accounts to just anybody and control those passwords very carefully, because that is your brand. That is you out there. And one rogue tweet, as several companies have found, you can be in a lot of trouble. Even companies as big as Starbucks, you get that one guy with a weird sense of humor and he sends out an ill-timed tweet and it can cost your leadership team hundreds of man hours to repair the damage.
Talk about what employee engagement means in the social age.
Well, here's another example in the industrial age where we talked directly at people. Our mentality was, you're easily replaceable, you're just helping us meet production quotas, you have a specific number to fill, and if you don't fill that, I'll just go find somebody else who does. There isn't a better example of talking at people instead of with people than the industrial age manufacturing mindset. And now this is completely shifted, because all it takes is one person, a minimum age worker, to get on to change.org, Facebook, Twitter, and start complaining about an egregious error that one of your managers made or leadership made, and it becomes national news, right? So we have to be very careful now about how we respond to those people. Threats don't work. Threatening them, you know, you're just lucky to have a job. Threats don't work. We actually have to be vulnerable. We have to be engaging. We actually have to have conversations, including starting the tough conversations with our employees now. We didn't have to do that before. We would just replace the malcontents. We would just replace them with somebody else that could do the same production work. And now it's just not like that.
In which industries have you seen some of the biggest shifts in the way business is done in this age?
Anything where your corporate presence is out there. Now, if you take a textile industry, they're kind of hiding, right? Even their own branding says, we don't make great things, we just make things greater, right? I mean, they're kind of that man behind the curtain. Literally every other industry that has a customer-facing portion of their work has changed. You talk about hospitality. Look what's happened to hotels, restaurants, Yelp, TripAdvisor. I mean, we can go find out everything there is to know about a hotel or a restaurant before we ever book the reservation, right? It has completely changed how the industry works. Before, it was always a marketing message. Oh, stay at our great hotel on the beach. And then you go on TripAdvisor now and you find out, well, it's 6 blocks away from the beach and it's through a neighborhood of homeless people between the hotel and the beach. And no, this is only gets a 2.2 rating, not the 5-star rating they claim. And there's our reality point, right? So especially the hospitality industry has been greatly affected by the social age.
You also talk about innovation in your book and how organizations are now innovating differently in the social age. How is innovation being done?
Well, you know, gone are the days where that lonely guy in 3M invents the post-it notes in his lab, right? Innovation today is done through crowdsourcing. It's done through community. It's done by people who don't even work for your company, but have an idea for your product. They believe so much in your brand. They're so loyal to a person or a product that they actually get on Twitter and say, hey, it would be really cool, Nike, if your running shoes would do this. And they're offering innovative ideas to the companies. Well, the best companies like Nike, they're taking advantage of that. They're bringing in their brand ambassadors. They're bringing in their loyal customers and saying, what are we doing well? What are we not? Again, how can we make your life better? And they're asking those questions and getting some really good answers that are leading to crowdsourced innovations.
Can you give us an example?
Perhaps the best example is the cottage industry that's grown from this. There are actually organizations now who, in a business-to-business model, will create these innovative little pockets for you. And they'll say you're a running shoe company, and they'll sit down with these people and they'll actually talk to them for you. They'll say, whoever comes up with the best idea for a new running shoe gets a $50,000 college scholarship. And they're actually innovating outside the R&D model and coming up with some really cool ideas.
Would you say this is a better way of doing things than it was in the past?
Well, better is always subjective. That old white guy probably doesn't think it's too better. But when we talk to the employees, when we talk to the difference makers, they feel finally like they're actually connected to their work. And you look, and you don't want to stereotype generations, but you look at how important that is to millennials and to Gen Z. They don't understand this work-life balance. I don't know how it was when you were growing up, but when my dad came home from the lumber mill at 5:15 every day, work was over. And you didn't think about working. And you had dinner, you watched the Sullivan Show, you did whatever you had to do, and then you 7:15 the next morning, you went back to work. And life is not like that anymore. We're constantly connected. And when you make people feel or help people feel that level of commitment, that level of engagement where they want to be part of the process all the time, then that can't be a bad thing.
Have you seen that employee engagement has gone up in certain industries who have been able to embrace the social age? Because there is still a lot of research out there that says that employees are not engaged.
Well, we call it anti-engagement. Even with all the technology we have available to us, we're still doing it the wrong way. We still have that software program that says, hey, it's Beth's 50th year anniversary today, go say hello. Well, it's gotta be more than that. You have to walk the floor. You have to actually talk to people. You have to have a one-on-one conversation, not because some software program told you to do it, but because it's the right thing to do. And we still don't hire for that. We still haven't figured out how to make our leaders into mentors. And that's what people really want. And that's where employee engagement really starts to become fertile, is when people feel like their manager, their boss, their boss's boss actually cares about them as people. That's when engagement comes up. Now, you're right, the stats on employee engagement still show. We've been talking about this for 20 years. We haven't made a single dent in this. But the companies who have that CEO that walks the floor, that has that manager that cares, they're seeing huge increases in employee engagement. Yeah.
Talk more about the importance of community in the social age, in the workplace.
For me, this is one of the most exciting parts of the social age. We have gone from these monoliths that talk at people to actually using our workforce, using our customer base for good. And you look at the rate of volunteering and how it's gone up, and the beach cleanup days, all starts with a social tweet. Our recent marches last weekend started with a single post on Facebook. And these social movements are happening all the time. And companies, organizations that are leveraging that are doing very well. And it all starts with making people feel like they're not just a customer, but they're on the right side of that red velvet rope. You know, they feel like they belong. They feel like they're part of something bigger. And that's the key word, belonging. We all want to feel like, whether it's church or a soccer club or whatever, we want to feel like we're part of something. And that's what the great brands are doing. You're not just selling them running shoes, you're selling them a community that cares.
Can you talk a little bit about the ROI of community for an organization? Perhaps if you can't do it in monetary terms, some of the other benefits.
Well, loyalty comes to mind immediately. I mean, think about how the companies that have done this this community building very well, like a Nike, like a Puma. You know, Puma for a while was, nobody ever heard of Puma And it became this little European micro company. And now they're all over the place. And everybody under the age of 28 wants to wear Puma because they started building this community around higher end, very comfortable, in a very profitable way that brought community members back to them over and over and over again. And they're a great example of a company that went from almost non-existent to extremely relevant all through community building.
How do they do that? What are some of the steps they took to do that?
They reach out. They become honest. In Puma's case, they actually owned it. Like, we know we're the little guys, but here's what we got for you, right? And they did amazing work in this area. You take a Denny's restaurant, again, a brand that almost laughable, but they started embracing that label, right? They started talking about how weird some of their food was. And yes, you might only come to see us at 1 a.m., after having a couple drinks, but come see us anyway, right? And they started embracing that weirdness, and again, they built a community around that, and Denny's, of all places, became cool again.
So you're building that with your customers, that sense of community. How do you do that within the organization?
That's the real key, because we, for a long time, the industrial age said customers first, and in the social age, we actually think the exact opposite. We think employees first. Because how can we ask our employees to treat our customers well if they don't feel like they're being treated well, right? And this was not an American thing. This actually started in India with a big telecom company. And they said, no, we're going to treat our employees well first so they can then treat our customers well. And, I mean, let's face it, how many times have you called into a call center and got a grumpy employee on the phone? It's not a great experience, right? So we've learned now that to take care of our employees well not only builds community, but it actually extends our employer brand and our corporate brand. We become positive ambassadors of the company we work for.
So in an age where we need to be nimble and always thinking ahead and making sure we stay in front of the competition, and how do large organizations adapt and survive to that?
Well, that's a great question. Baby steps is the answer. There are so many tools that we can use. Again, instead of putting 13 suits in a room to solve a problem, let's get the right people in the right room at the right time. Let's create this little sense of community and say, together we have this challenge and we're gonna fix it. This people in this room are the right people to fix that challenge. No bureaucracy, no titles, no suits. We're gonna fix this problem. And whatever solution we come up with, we're going to embrace it corporate wide. So let's go to work, right? Again, you're building community. You're building what we call a contagious pocket of excellence. Because when you start problem solving this way, and it doesn't take weeks or months or years to solve a systemic problem, but hours, maybe days, people are going to look up and go, wow, how'd you do that? And then you get to talk about your solution-focused work groups and your pockets of excellence, and it becomes contagious. And it doesn't matter how big your company is or how bureaucratic it is. If you just take these little micro teams and go start solving problems, people notice.
So in an organization that is large, that has a big hierarchy, but wants to become flatter, how can they do this without being too disruptive to the organization?
Well, there's the real problem, right? Because most bureaucracies come with, let's say, 13 layers of management, when probably 4 or 5 would do. But again, we're replacing an industrial age paradigm with a social age model. And in the industrial age, we had to have one manager for every 8 people, right? Depending on your industry, maybe 12 people, maybe 6 people. And now, no, we hire good people that we can trust and we let them do their job, which means we don't have to have that many managers anymore. Well, if you're a legacy company, you've had your chain of command for a long time. And it's hard to take those 20, 25-year employees and say, you're not going to be a manager anymore. And so it is disruptive and it is hard and it is painful, but it has to be done. To compete well today, it has to be done. I mean, look at the taxi industry and look what Uber and Lyft have done to that industry, completely disrupted the companies who wanted to hang on to their hierarchical processes.
What advice do you have for some of these old school leaders who haven't been able to embrace some of the social changes that are taking place?
Boy, what a wonderful question. We actually have a solution that we recommend to every one of our clients, and that's go find a reverse mentor. Go find somebody that's 23, 24 years old, that just is ready to take life by the horns, and just go hang out with them a little bit. Watch how they use social. Watch how they engage with the customers and the employees. And just leave the ivory tower behind, wear jeans that day, and just do the undercover boss thing and walk around with somebody who really gets it And you'll start to see, it becomes contagious even for that old white guy. They start to see how important this is, how you bring smiles to people. And those smiles, maybe we can't monetize those either, but you start to see the difference it makes. And you want to be a part of that. And that all makes sense, but we have to let go, right? It's hard to take that $2,000 suit off, right? It's hard to give up the town car service on the way to work, you know, but you gotta get in there. You gotta get your hands dirty. That's the only way to make change happen.
Can you give us an example of a leader who perhaps was stuck in the industrial age, but then was able to go ahead and embrace some of the changes of the social age and how he did that?
I was actually fortunate enough to be with a CEO in a company that I worked with and for do that. And that's actually what inspired a lot of the book and a lot of our work is we had a CEO of a startup that I was part of that he just didn't get it. The entire founding team just didn't get how to run a company and how to build a great culture. And a man named Bud walked in one day and just turned everything on its ear. He started walking the floor. He started talking to everybody from the newest intern to the longest term employee. And he just started having these one-on-one conversations. He'd pour coffee for you in the break room. He'd walk the sales floor. And he just started embracing these one-on-one relationships. And it completely changed the dynamic of the office and the company. And the turnaround was amazing. Now, unfortunately, that company was so far down that they didn't get their next round of funding. But I got to witness this transformation happening. And it set bells off in my head that this is how business runs today. This is how people want to be treated today.
Tell us how social can help change a negative brand image.
That's one of the miraculous things about social is when a company decides to actually leave the world of denial and embrace how their customers and the public thinks about them and owns it and says, you know what, for the last 20 years, we've talked at you. Now we're going to start talking with you and we're going to own this. We're going to change your perception of us. Again, Denny's, great example of where they just said, no, we're taking this head on. We're not going to be in denial. We're not going to ride that train, you know, down into the Kodak hole and the Blockbuster hole. We're actually going to change. And even more important, they don't just talk about changing. They actually let change happen organically. They embrace what we call the testimonial economy. Rather than talking about themselves, they do great things for people and they start to let others talk about them so they don't have to talk, right? It's people out there on social media saying how great Panera Bread is or how wonderful you treated my grandmother when she wanted clam chowder right before she died, which is a great story of one store manager in Panera who on a Thursday was asked for clam chowder for a dying grandmother, and they said, I'm sorry, we only do clam chowder on Fridays. And the grand says, oh, this is my grandmother's like dying wish just to have some of your clam chowder. She loves it. So long story short, the store manager whips up some clam chowder. He takes it home, goes on Facebook, talks about how great Panera Bread is. 1 million comments later, the world knew how great Panera was, right? Their same in-store sales that quarter went up 27%. One bowl of clam chowder, right? It can be pretty impactful.
In your book, you also talk about a model, the open model, which stands for Ordinary People, Extraordinary Network. So this is supposed to be something that really helps people build lifelong relationships, and it's supposed to be a foundation to help organizations build successfully. Tell mm-hmm. us more about the model.
So Open is a brainchild of my co-author, Ted Koyne, and he's the one who noticed this first, that companies that were embracing this open model, that leaders that didn't think they had to have all the answers became more vulnerable, would sit in a room and say, okay, here's the challenge. Here's the resources we have available. What do you got? Right? Instead of being that autocrat that comes in and goes, we have a problem. Bill, you're going to do this. Beth, you're going to do that. They just opened the room up. And they would even invite, say they didn't have the right people to fix it. They'd invite competitors in. They'd invite industry experts in, consultants, consumers of a competitor's products and say, what are we doing wrong, right? And so you didn't have to be that leader that runs in on the white horse. you didn't have to have all the answers. You just had to know people who did have all the answers. And that's what open really means, is I don't have to be spectacular all the time. I don't have to have all the answers. But I want to surround myself with amazing people that do. And then when they come to me and I have an amazing answer for them, they won't mind when I go to them and say, hey, I got a problem and I think you can help. Can you come in for a minute? Right? And it isn't that you're constantly asking others for help. It's a mutually beneficial relationship. And people from all industries are seeing how powerful this is, where even if you have to bring in a competitor and go, look, we have an industry problem, and I think together we can fix it better than we can apart. What do you think? People are buying in everywhere.
Who are some of the greatest social leaders today?
Well, you know, I think it's easy to put Richard Branson, Arianna Huffington at the top of that list, and there's so many more. Where we see the biggest impact, though, is not with the huge companies. It's with the startups. It's with the local or community banks. You take, for example, Tangerine Bank, formerly ING Direct out of Canada. Peter Aceto, way back in 2008, saw this Twitter thing coming and went, you know what, this is pretty cool. I think I'm going to be a part of this. Now, this is a CEO. CEOs weren't on Twitter back then. The next week, he gets a complaint on Twitter from one of his major clients. Walks into work that morning and goes, challenge. Here it is right here in front of us. Tweets him back and says, I heard you. We got this. Well, a CEO talking directly to a customer? Unheard of, right? It mobilized his entire team. In less than 24 hours, had the entire problem fixed. And Tangerine Bank became known as one of the first social companies ever, all because Peter Aceto took the bull by the horns and actually jumped into social head first.
Can you give us an idea of what makes them good at social leading? So you gave one example of how he just got on the ball and responded to that customer. What else makes a leader good at social leading?
That's a great question. There's two aspects, undeniable aspects, that make a social leader have that huge impact. One is you have to be an active listener. You have to be willing to collect all the wisdom in the room before you make a decision. Does not absolve you of the responsibility to lead and to make those hard decisions, but when you actually listen to the input and make people feel like they're part of the solution, it becomes contagious. So that's one. Second thing is we have to be vulnerable. We have to stick our nose out there a little bit, even if it means it gets cut off once in a while. You have to let people know what you stand for and, frankly, what you won't stand for. That's a very precarious situation for a lot of old school leaders. They don't want to get that personal. I'm just going to get in the town car and I'm just going to go home, right? And it's a much different model than it was just a few years ago.
What are some things that an organization should have in place to ensure that they're building the right team for the social age?
Well, boy, another great question. We have learned a long time ago, I hope, that we can't just hire for technical skills. We have to hire for soft skills too. And first and foremost among those is emotional intelligence. How is that person going to get along with others? How are they going to get along with others when things aren't going well, right? Because we all get along when there's big wins, right? We all look past our faults to help celebrate. But when things aren't going well, when there is a challenge, how is that person going to react? And we have not done a good job of building teams around emotional intelligence. Now, add another layer onto that we talk a lot about, and that's social intelligence, right? Social intelligence is a whole different layer. And it isn't the old school definition of social intelligence that we can just sit here and carry on a conversation human to human, but also what's your brand like online? How are you perceived by your digital community? How will you represent the company online? Are you going to be an ambassador, or are you going to be the person that runs to change.org as soon as something bad happens, right? And most importantly, when something bad does happen, are you the kind of person that's going to be part of the solution or become a victim? And that's what emotional and social intelligence help us measure. And if every HR department in the world would hire for those two skills, we'd start building socially enabled teams.
How do you assess whether your organization is actually ready for this type of change, ready for this open network, as you've called it?
Well, I love this question because it implies that you're actually trying to learn if your organization is ready or not, rather than just mandating change like TQM, like Six Sigma. It's a whole different world when you actually say, are we really ready for this? Or do we have the right people in place? Do we have the right champions of change? And the fact is, most companies don't. And this is where we get back to, rather than making this large-scale change, take one team that is ready and start enabling their change. Build that pocket of excellence. Start working on the solution-focused work groups and make it be contagious. Don't mandate change. Don't test it. See if it works within your organization. If you come up and say, okay, we're all on Twitter from now on, you're going to have some trolls on Twitter you didn't ever want on Twitter, right? So you have to take little teams, little pockets, and build from there. And to our point about emotional and social intelligence, all your hires from now on have to be based on that, or your team's never going to be ready, right? Trolls eventually weed themselves out. When your company starts to change and they don't want to be part of that social change, they're going to go find someplace else to work. This will no longer be comfortable for them. They'll no longer want to listen to customers. They don't take the time to listen to employees. They'll self-select. Attrition, when it comes to this kind of change, is undoubtedly our best friend.
Now, would you say there's a difference between marketing and social media marketing?
Oh, well, I wish there wasn't, but it's still so new. The social age is still only 10 years old, maybe. So we're still babies at this. And so we call it social recruiting instead of recruiting. Social media marketing instead of marketing. There will come a day very soon now that we won't have that qualifier on the beginning or the end, that we'll just see it for what it is. It is a marketing channel. It is an engagement method. I can't wait until we just say, okay, marketing team instead of social media marketing team. What do you got, right? The social age will have finally taken hold when we start adding the word social in front of everything. Social recruiting, social listening, right? It's just recruiting. It's just listening. Social media is just the tool.
Right. Right now, do you see it being sort of broken up within organizations?
In too many. As a matter of fact, it's so funny to me that you will have people designated to the social listening team. Sometimes they have entire social command centers where you're watching every tweet, every hashtag that's relevant to your industry, and they say that's social customer service or social listening, but customer service is in another building or another town or another state, and we haven't fully incorporated it yet, and it's a mistake, and we didn't realize that at first. We were just happy we were listening, right? And we did do some good things, but now we're mature enough where social aspects of our business need to be integrated into what people would consider a normal aspect of the business, like customer service.
Talk about the power of content and how content marketing really works.
Well, content marketing, again, it's had its phases already, right, in the last 10 years. We went from anything we say online will be considered expertise, and any way we promoted that was okay. So we started spamming and self-promoting, and we're just throwing crap out there. It was just terrible, right? That was kind of phase one of content marketing. Now, with all the noise, and everybody's a blogger and everybody's an expert, now we have to differentiate. We actually have to prove our value within just a short paragraphs by taking on a specific topic that somebody might have had a question on for months, and boom, here's our answer, right? There's value in that. And that's what good content marketing does. It provides value to your customers, your potential customers, maybe your employees, certainly your industry, that nobody'd heard before. It wasn't just the same old. This was actually valuable content. And by doing that, you position yourself and your company as a subject matter expert. So ideally, let's just say it's roofing. If you talk about how a do-it-yourself technique for roofing that nobody's ever talked about, a trade secret, and somebody gains something from that, next time they need roofing materials, where are they gonna go? They're gonna go to you because you helped them. Now they wanna help you back, right? That's a very basic example, but that's what good content marketing does. It puts our customers in a position of loyalty.
What if an organization does finally embrace social change and gets on social media, starts blogging, you know, has their employees, the leaders, but no one responds? What if no one's reading it?
Well, that happens to all of us. We started a talent community called YouTern, and for the first 6, 7, maybe 9 months of our existence, it was crickets. It was like we were writing these great blogs, and nobody knew us, and we weren't on the search engines yet, and we just couldn't get any traction at all. It was just brutal. But it, again, it happens to all of us. And here's the deal: we all have to start somewhere. We may be the best experts in a particular subject, but if people don't know us for that, then it's going to take a while. And in the case of YouTern, within a year or so, after dealing with these, you know, this echo chamber, that it felt like nobody was reading our stuff, all of a sudden we were in Mashable, and Mashable named us a top five site for starting your career. And now people knew us, and we were recognized for valuable content, and it just took off. And that seems to be what happens. We have to be willing to allow our content and our social media presence to hit a tipping point. And it does take a while. It is an investment. But if you're doing it right, eventually people start to recognize you as an authentic authority in your topic of expertise, and you will start to see an ROI.
So is it just keep at it, or did you do specific things?
Well, keep SEO. At it and learn along the way, right? Mm-hmm. What works, what doesn't work, what topic is catching people's eyes, right? In our case, in the career space, everybody was doing a post on how to make your resume better, right? And we said, look, the posts that are a little edgier are actually getting more attention. So I wrote a blog post one time, 7 Reasons Your Resume Sucks. And it got 20,000 page views in a week, right? Because we took an edgier, funnier, we stuck our necks out there a little bit, and it paid off in a big way.
Tell us how organizations are using the cloud and big data and analytics to help drive their social media strategy.
Well, this is, again, one of the most exciting things about this is when we first entered the social age, it was a lot of trial and error. We really didn't know what worked and what didn't. We didn't know what tweets were gaining traction and doesn't. Now, 10 years into this process, there's so many tools, and we can look, and some of them are free, and we can look and see what posts did well, what tweets did well, what content did well, what our customers responded better to than others, and we're actually fine-tuning our value based on those analytics. And it's quite an exciting premise. It's a lot better than just throwing stuff out there and seeing what sticks. It's actually quite inventive. Now, there is a downside to this, in that we're now steering all of our content and some of our noise toward what everybody else is steering toward, because that's what resonated that week or that month or the month before. And so we're losing some of our originality. We're losing some of that edginess. We're losing some of what made us different to begin with, because we're kind of migrating toward the popular instead of the stuff that really made a difference. And so there's a downside to that. We all can't shoot for the golden goose, right? We have to remember what our niche is and what got us here. And we're losing some of that now.
Because it's all a learning process.
Oh, right? It is. But analytics is a huge help. I mean, when we can look at something, real data, and say, this worked, this didn't, let's without losing ourselves in the process, let's move this way, it makes a big difference in our business. Yeah.
Tell us what the social organization is going to look like in the future.
Well, that's a tough one, because it's definitely flatter. It's definitely more inclusive, but a lot of the challenges that we're facing now with the social age issues, digital issues, social media platforms, content, they're being blocked by the same people who are blocking other issues important to us, inclusivity, gender bias. To this day, there's 12 people on a board of directors and 11 of them are going to be white men, right? And so a lot of this, we're still fighting some of these same prejudices, some of these same issues that bring out this defense mechanism in the people that are leading now. And it's not isolated to just transitioning or transformation of the social age. It's every other aspect of this where control is, or keeping control is more important than doing the right thing. And so that's what we're seeing more than anything else is, how are we going to convince these old white guys that they don't need to be in charge all the time, that they don't need to be in power, that diversity and inclusion is better for our companies, better for our organizations? And social is part of that, right? Because as we've seen over and over again in our latest presidential election here, people want to have a voice. They want to be part of the solution. And when it's 12 guys sitting up in the board controlling everything, that makes it pretty hard to do. So what's a social organization going to look like? I think in the best organizations, it is going to be inclusive. It is going to be highly diverse. We are going to collect all the wisdom in the room from a variety of different sources and backgrounds and experiences. And that's the best of all worlds. But we're not quite there yet. We have some work to do.
What do leaders and organizations need to do to ensure that they're staying one step ahead of the social game so that they're not playing catch up when it counts?
Well, we can't, as leaders, we're already working long hours, right? We're already probably workaholics, probably type A's, probably lots on our plate. We can't all of a sudden become social media experts. And now we're going to ask you to spend 2-3 hours a day on social media or writing a blog or appearing on USA Today or whatever. It's simply not going to happen, right? So we have to take this slowly, and we have to build the right team. And maybe the CEO doesn't have to be the face of the company, but somebody in the C-suite does. So delegate. Let yourself come along slowly. Get that reverse mentor. Get somebody to show you the ropes and how this works and how it doesn't work. And let yourself slowly become more vulnerable, slowly become a bigger part of the process. And it's a wonderful model, and it's worked over and over again for many organizations.
Tell us a little bit about your professional journey and how you got to where you are today.
Well, I am one of those guys. I've had 6 or 7 different careers. I joined the military at 17. They paid for my education. I did the Silicon Valley engineer thing for about 10 years before I threw my hands up and said, oh, this sucks. This is not who I'm supposed to be. I had a mentor at the time who helped me transition, still within the engineering world, but into sales and marketing, and that's in TQM. And so we started building a great organization that actually listened to our customers, did some amazing work that got national attention, because in the semiconductor world, who listens to their customers? That does not happen. And it worked so well that I actually went out on my own. I did the same thing for IBM, for Silicon Graphics, and Sun Microsystems, and we actually started working with high-tech companies on how to speak business and how engineers can speak business, and we had a lot of fun. We did that for a decade, and as life would have it, stuff happens, and I suddenly found myself divorced and a single dad of 4 kids, and had to work from home. 4 kids, 9 to 1.5. We're not going to do the corporate job anymore. And so I went into the startup world, and that changed my life. And it was when I could make decisions or help make decisions that were instantly implemented, I went, oh my God, this is how life is supposed to be. I don't have to have corporate approval. Let's do the right thing starting right now. And so it was just this aha moment for me that this is where I belong. This is where I needed to be. And so I've been in the startup world and ever since. And that's what led me, again, we talked earlier about the transition that I went through in the company. And I saw how one leader can make that big of a difference. And that's who I wanted to be. And that's who I wanted to help from that point on. And it's been an exciting journey.
And you are the founder and CEO of YouTern. Mm-hmm. Tell us a little bit about that organization.
So YouTern is an organization that helps college students, recent graduates, young professionals ascend into the workforce as gracefully as possible. So rather than just living the big lie is quite simple. Your parents say, go to high school, get good grades, play sports, maybe do speech and debate, community service. To have a decent GPA, you'll go to college. Rinse and repeat all of that again. Get your degree, and there'll be a great job waiting for you when you graduate. And that stopped being true 20 years ago. But we're still teaching the big lie. So U-Turn is here to help people realize how important something other than that college degree is. Internships, finding the right mentors, building a personal board of advisors to help you cut down some of the learning curves. We talk a lot about personal branding and social proof. Everything that a young careerist might need to get that first job out of college or shortly out of college. And it's a pretty good way to make a living. We literally help people every day achieve their dreams, and it's fun.
What have you learned from some of your successes?
That success is a short-timer thing. It doesn't last very long, right? Especially now. And you see this all the time. You see the hottest startup gone in 3 years, right? And so we have to stay relevant. We have to stay social. We have to keep building relationships, and we have to keep learning. I mean, we've talked the whole interview about old white guys. If there's one thing that separates those kind of leaders from everybody else is they stopped learning a long time ago. They were arrogant enough to think they knew everything already, right? I'm the CEO. I don't have to learn anymore. And when that happens, it's just brutal. It's brutal when reality sets. So That consistent learning thing, you have to do it both when you're being successful and when you're failing.
Talk a little bit about that, some of the lessons that you've learned from your failures.
I think that's even more important, right? Now, I am not one of these people that worships failure. I hate failure. It sucks. One out of every three tweets on Twitter, it seems, or Facebook, is about learning from your failures. And I think we've turned into a society, especially an entrepreneurial society, that worships that. I am not that guy. I just hate failure. I'm a competitor. I love to win, and failure hurts. But it happens. Here's the thing I learned is you cannot let it turn you into a victim. You got to own it. And that's, especially in the startup world, it happens all the time. I've had an idea for a new startup that has literally been sitting there for 3 years and has gone nowhere. And it kills me, but every day I learn something from that experience. And one of the things I've learned is you absolutely have to have the right team. Now, whether it's your personal team, the people you socialize with, your family, you have to have positive, productive people surrounding you. And if you don't, you have to upgrade that team. And that's what I've learned most from the failures.
All right, Mark. Well, this was great. Thank you so much for joining us
today.
You.
Thank you for having me.
Thanks. And we'll see you next time on Sarder TV.